My name is Philip Tuju, aka Fila, and this is my story.
If you had a chance to take a look at our first clip that we did with Fila, I mean, we spoke about great things, and just in case you missed it, here is a small snippet.
I remember you guys even did something at Coke Studio with
yes,
the boys.
Immediately now, because as a result of this, yes, you know, Coke Studio always picks up the trending group at
yes,
that time to be
yes,
involved in the recordings.
Yeah.
So I think that's when they reached out to South Soul, and South Soul were able
yeah,
to tell us, okay, let's do this song.
Yes.
And then that's the time that now South Soul decided that they're actually going to redo Kuliko Jana, a cappella mm-hmm, version, and that's where now we decided, okay, let's do it. And
right,
I think that's what now changed the profile of both the school and
yes,
now the choir. But now I saw that this was the opportunity for me to now mm-hmm, really build my vision, because I wanted
yes,
to move the choir away from just being an Upper Hill thing.
Mm-hmm.
Right, welcome back. And so we are going to go into the deep of things.
Yeah.
Fila,
mm-hmm,
now things have happened, and somebody looking at you is imagining, I life your Fila in a chorus, man.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, any Coke Studio, man,
yeah,
Red Fork
yes,
chorus, man. Yeah, big things, YouTube's 50,000 views.
Tama
shall make it. This guy is a millionaire.
Ah.
What was the journey like for you? Did you ever imagine at any given point I'm going to give up?
I don't know how to answer that, because
yeah,
the truth is that I've always felt, up to even as soon as last week,
yeah,
I've always felt that I feel like giving up. But the truth is that there's nothing else to do.
This is this.
Yeah, there's nothing else to
yeah,
do. Nothing will ever feel right.
Yeah.
This is the thing that I love most, but it's the thing that has broken my heart the most. You know, my worst moments has been as a result of, you know, starting this whole thing called Red Fort and just following this passion called music.
I'm curious, what do you mean your worst moments?
My worst moments is I've come close to being auctioned.
You're
you know,
kidding!
I'm serious, I've come close to being auctioned, I've come close to, you know, losing friends, I've lost friends, I've been told really bad things by people who I expected to understand where I'm coming from and what I'm going through, and this burden
yes,
of trying to do something just for a whole generation that
yes,
is going to come many years, and just making a contribution to this whole inspiration through music. And it has been frustrating. But what motivated me to follow this dream even stronger? I mean, my biggest challenge growing up, well, I grew up in a family that was, you know, we were well off, you know. I saw my dad rising up in life, his business doing very well. I saw him, you know, make more and more money. I had the privilege, myself and my sister had the privilege of being moved from a public school, and I was taken to a very high cost primary school. And that, I think those are the moments that changed my life, when I realized that, well, there's a normal life. And then
there are real
people. I mean, you go from a school where you guys are just normal, and then you realize that, guys, there are people who are living in this world. You know, I was schooling with children of ministers, children of MPs, people who are considered powerful. And I saw that these kids, what I learned is that these kids, as much as they were from wealthy families, they also had been taught what drive is and what working hard is. So they're wealthy, but at the same time they have the drive to continue. So now it all made sense why these people are going to remain rich,
mm-hmm,
you know. And you know, that is one of the greatest gratitude that I have to my dad and my mom for giving me that opportunity. But now, in just about 2 years of being in that high cost school, my dad's business crumbled when I was just about to sit for my KCP exams,
mm-hmm,
and that, I think, now that changed everything for me. But what I was grateful most for was that I tasted what
that's
a good life is. we were living in Karen, everything, we had a big house, and we lost everything, and we went back to to not just living in a two-bedroom house that is, you know, squeezed, and everyone, we were five kids and everything. So, but that changed my life, and that now gave me the motivation, because I knew what having it easy is. But now we've lost everything and we've gone back lower than we ever started. So that gave me the motivation that if I'm going to do anything, I want to do it well. But then again, I was still a young man. I was still, you know, I haven't decided what I want to do. But what I knew is that I'd fallen in love with music, and I loved the way music was something that I could express myself. Of course, my foundation in music came from the family altars that we used to have. So that's why I say it came easy for me, because I got those early, early foundation in singing. We sang in the house, and now I used music as my own escape for the pain that I was feeling. Our family was going through a lot, so I used to sing it out, because again, I was shy, I wasn't able to express myself, so I used the music. Even when I was called to Upper Hill, I used the music again to just to express myself and to sort of, you know, just make myself feel good about something, and it got me to places. So from the first time I sang at the Christian Union, just small meeting, through that I was invited into Voice in the Light as a form one, which is the main Christian nursing group, and through that now I became the choir leader. I eventually became the leader of the Voice in the Light, and eventually I became a senior prefect in school. And everything just through the music, it helped me, and we formed a group later. We toured the world, but even before we toured, I decided that I still had the dream of teaching many other people, because I'd learned how to train choirs in Upper Hill. So I started training Moi girls immediately I cleared high school. And I remember I used to walk from that time, my dad had lost the job, so we had moved to Rongai in a very small house. So I used to walk from Rongai all the way to Langata, so that we could go for practice with the group in Aboretum. So, because that from Langata now to town, I'd get a cheaper ride for about 30 shillings, and then I'd pay that, and then we go for practice. And then now from Aboretum, I walk to Moi girls to train the choir. And then if Upper Hill, I'm given permission by the school to train the boys in the night, because I wanted to teach as many schools so that I could sort of also just stamp my authority I was very young, but I could be able to stamp my authority as a choir director.
I know it meant a lot for you. It's quite a struggle.
Yes.
How does it make you feel? Because now we have talked here and there behind the scenes.
Yes.
People who do not have TSC numbers should not be allowed.
Very
to,
true. You know,
when you hear of that kind of a thing, how do you feel?
Well, it's something that breaks my heart a lot, and I've experienced it.
Yes.
It's something that I've experienced it with the, you know, I used to be able to teach so many schools.
Yes.
And then I personally wasn't doing it for money, but I'm imagining the platform that it gave me to grow and to also inspire so many other young people. I remember the many girls who are inspired, who are doing well right now in the music. The many boys who are inspired, who are doing well right in the music. I was a performer. I was teaching them performance. I wasn't teaching them academics in class. So I'm not the kind of person that you would expect to get a TSC number so that I can be able to teach. Because again, what I wanted to study wasn't education. So now I struggle a lot to imagine that the government is considering, you know, just doing away with any extra teachers who are just going to give certain skills to the students who are not necessarily teachers. You know, it's just sort of like just being a consultant. So I think that is something that should be opened up for other young people, and any person who's gifted in a particular skill to be able to impact the youth. But yes, so that was a struggle. I remember walking up, and you know, at the end when the girls, particularly at my girls, when they became number one, I remember that, you know, girls of course would want to give you a gift. And then again, also the age difference at that time, because I just cleared high school, so these were pretty much girls who were sort of in my age group. So our level of interaction was not really the one that you call between a teacher-student.
Yes.
Though I always tried to maintain that discipline of, called here as a trainer.
Yeah.
So I remember them buying me a gift, and when I opened the gift at home, it was deodorant. You know, it was Dio. You know, I felt, you know,
they're like, oh man.
You know, they're trying to say something, and you know, but I felt it was funny, but because I remember I used to.
You've been walking to rehearsals.
I used to walk. But the mistake that I used to make, I had one brown, and I think that's why I fell in love with brown pants. I had a brown pants like this, beat, and then had an ink stain somewhere
here.
And I used to have, I borrowed a sleeveless shirt from a short sleeve shirt from my brother. And I remember I used to sit on the piano. It was a piano like this, on an upright piano. Yeah. I used to sit on the piano and all the girls are in their room.
Yes.
So it was a cramped up room and it used to be very hot.
Yes.
I think girls call it something they call that hall that they have on the back side.
Yeah.
And I remember I used to sit on the piano, okay, because I didn't have time. By 5:30 the girls have to go for supper.
Yeah.
So I start playing the piano, giving them their parts.
Yeah.
And you can see sweat is just dripping. It's just dripping from my but those are the times that define me. After that I go back to Upper Hill and then it was so funny. At Upper Hill, I remember there's one time that I got paid from, like, I got paid because State House Girls is the only school that paid me.
Mm-hmm.
So I got paid from State House, so I bought new trousers. And then I remember one guy just commented, because again, the age difference wasn't too much.
Yes.
So I'm like a young guy to them. So he said something, maybe you're saying it for fun, but to me, it really.
Because
he said, hey, fill up, check your jama menunua, and then your trousers. You know, and I was like,
they've been seeing you every other day with the same trousers.
Hey, you need trousers, Zambia. Even at Sitos Girls, I remember a girl, I just noticed that one of the girls is smiling. And then later after the, at least she was a bit courteous, after the rehearsal, she came and just told me, hey, Fila, congrats.
Congrats.
I mean, it broke my heart, you know, but those are the things that I remember. I used to be, we used to go for rehearsal with Pentamony. We were going through hell at home. We didn't have food to eat. We didn't have, even the transport money was a struggle.
Yeah.
And it's not that my mom or dad didn't want to give me the money, but there's no money for food. And I remember we just used to drink porridge.
Yeah.
And then what was your sort? And then most of us were men. The only person who used to be taken care of a bit again, but also she didn't have it easy, was my small sister.
Yeah.
So I remember I used to go to Aboretum, and my friends Benson and Seamus would, you know, collect the money.
And Benson have to chunga some 30 minutes.
They have to contribute money for me to get home. But what I can't tell them, you see, because we were all as a group suffering, but at least them, they're coming from homes that at that time, it's just you can make ends meet. But for us, it was hard. But what I couldn't tell them, because we never used to eat when we go for rehearsals as a group. Because, I mean, that's a luxury, you know. And now what I needed to tell them, guys, give me transport to get to Rongai. But I used to walk now from town to Madaraka now.
Yes.
Madaraka in the evening, it's a bit cheaper.
Yeah.
So I go train Upper Hill first, and then I make sure that I leave late so that I can get a cheap ride from Madaraka to get to Rongai. So now they used to give me the money that would be equivalent from town to Rongai. So this money that I've saved on here is what I'd use to eat something. At least now, because I haven't eaten the whole day, I haven't done anything the whole day. So that was what I did for a long time until now. I got my footing into the schools and I used to now be able to quote and be able to tell people, okay, this is how much I charge to train a choir, and this is the track record. I have these certificates, the schools have done well. So I got Ngara Girls, I got different schools. So again, now I was stretching myself. I was teaching, there was a time I was teaching 5 schools,
just to be able to
make money and also be able to push with my agenda.
Yeah.
So that was a challenge. But you know, right now I'm at that time I thought that was tough. I thought that I'm going through hell.
Lo and behold,
we went to Norway, we made some good money that I'd never seen. I remember I looked at my bank account and hey, there was good money. Then today I sit and say that was a joke. You know, because I'm wondering if you give me that money today,
it will do nothing.
But I imagine that I was paid that money when we came from Norway, when we did the tour and we did well. And of course, Norway opened my eyes and I did good with that money because it was my opportunity to move out. I was ready to move out of home and live in a bed. I thank God that that is a stage that I was able to jump because of the job that we'd done in Norway. And now I moved out for a year. Everything is going well because I have a lot of money to cushion myself, even though I'm not making money from anywhere. I can eat what I want. So that's where now I got my weight from. So because now, I had compensated for all the years, you know. And then, so everything went well. I made sure that I bought the biggest TV that I could find, the biggest home theater. These were things that I had never seen, you know, for a very long time at home. So I really sort of blessed myself. And then now reality now sinks in because now you're now leaving. Now the honeymoon phase is more or less over.